الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه ومن اهتدى بهديه وسن سنته إلى يوم الدين. The few ayat that before this Allah سبحانه وتعالى explaining to us the reality and what each group on the day of judgment will be facing. And the ayat after this is gonna emphasize that we as human being, we have a choice. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not twisting our arm. We choose the way we want, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us and facilitate us to go this way. So we choose our destiny, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in the interim, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala provide for us all the tools that should make us believer. Okay, so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us everything, and then it is up to us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in ayah 36, he say, وَلَقَدْ بَعَثْنَا فِي كُلِّ أُمَّةٍ رَسُولًا. There is no nation that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not send a messenger to. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had that the original covenant with us when we were nothing but something in the loins of our fathers. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not hold us responsible until our brains we come to purity and our brains develop and we understand things, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the universe. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us all the tools, and he send the messengers. And the messengers were Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give them proof, give them miracle that they are messenger from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he say, I did my part. وَلَقَدْ بَعَثْنَا فِي كُلُّ أُمَّةِ الرَّسُولِ أَنِ اعْبُدُوا اللَّهَ وَاجْتَنِبُوا الطَّاغُوتِ. Worship Allah and stay away from الطاغوت. الطاغوت, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he say, فَلَمَّا طَغَى الْمَاءِ. الطاغوت, anybody who cross the line. Okay, so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he say, when the water goes over, that is tughyan. I understand this. So anybody who cross the lines of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in excess, this is taghut. Okay, وَاجْتَنِبُوا الطَّاغُوتِ. Stay away from taghut. فَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ هَدَى اللَّهِ. Among these people, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the tools. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say, among humanity, there is a group that Allah guided. فَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ هَدَى اللَّهِ وَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ حَقَّتْ عَلَيْهِمُ الضَّلَالَةِ. But the other group, they deserve to be misguided. Okay, فَسِيرُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ. Just walk throughout the earth. فَانْظُرُوا كَيْفَ كَانَ عَقِبَةُ الْمُكَذِّبِينَ. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not only tell us about himself, does not tell us only about haram and the halal, does not tell us about the universe, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he say, these are the stories of the people before you, and this is what I did to them when they reject. And this is not secret. You can go in the landscape and you see them. You go to Egypt, you go to Jordan, you go to all these places where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talk about Ad, Thamud, Qawm Salih, all of them. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, fasiru fil ard, go in the landscape, fanzuru, look at what was the end of these people.
So really, all the messenger came with one message, which is really tawheed.
An'abudullah, yes. Yeah.
And
wajtanibu al-taghut. Absolutely. There is a big difference between the message and the way you worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Each nation, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, from Adam until Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, until the day of judgment, the message is worship Allah, nobody else. That's the message. But how to worship Allah, that developed through the years. Okay? For instance, we know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, nations before us, Allah prescribed fasting to them. But was it the same exact fasting like us? We know it was not. Okay, praying, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, everybody has pray, charity, everything. But the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala design the way he is worshipped, it differs from one nation to the other nation. So the ulama say there is two types of guidance. Okay, well, a guidance of choice. You and I, two kids, you have two kids at home, and you raise them with you know, tremendous care and stuff like this, and you teach them and you show them the good way and the bad way. One choose to be good and one choose to be bad. It is the same environment, the same family, the same parents, the same treatment, but somebody choose to go this route and somebody choose this route. Here is the ni'mah from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if I choose the wrong road, Allah does not leave me alone. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put in my way obstacles and detest me, so I go back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give me everything. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not punish me right away. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make me sick, something happened to me, whatever it is, so I can go back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But if you insist, there is something called a deserving misguidance. You choose to be misguided. No matter the lesson that you go through, no matter the advices that you have, and you still misguided, and you promote misguidance, and you have no problem, and you even want everybody else to be misguided. And when you choose that, after all the trials and the lesson of Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will ease your way and will leave you alone, so you're going to be misguided. So there is I choose the right road. If I choose that, Allah help me to go to the destiny. If I choose the other one, and regardless of what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put in my way and the lessons and the trials and everything, if I choose, this is what we call the rewarded misguidance. That's what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say, وَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ حَقَّتْ عَلَيْهِ الضَّلَالَةِ, which means they deserve to be misguided. You understand this?
Quick question. You give the example of two kids of the same parents.
Yes.
So now we know that the shaitan is never relenting.
Yes.
He's always okay. So one of the kids, he has the strong willpower to resist the shaitan's influence.
Yes.
The other kid, unfortunately for him, he's weaker. He cannot resist the temptation that the shaitan throws in his way. And he goes, is he to be blamed entirely? I mean,
you blame him? Okay. Yeah. If this kid came and slapped you in the face, I'm not, forget about Dean now.
No, huh?
He slapped you in the face. Would you say he is weak? You're gonna kill him, right?
Not kill.
No. I'm that's a figure of speech. Okay?
Right.
Here is the thing.
Right.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when you think about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, anything that remotely resemble injustice, that's not Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. People do injustice because I am weak. I want to take what you have. Huh? You understand this? But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not do injustice. So this person, when in our society, when somebody kill, we do not say he's weak. You understand? We kill him. When somebody steal, we punish him. But when somebody disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we say he's weak. In reality, لا يكلف الله نفسا إلا وسعها. There is a big difference between, because the influence of the shaitan is on both of them. It is not I am weak. It is I want to take the easy road. You understand this? It's not a weakness. If there is an inherent weakness in me, it is not Allah, hasha lillah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will never hold me responsible. You understand this? So anything that is out of my control, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will never hold me responsible. That's why intellect Reasoning is a precondition for commissioning. If you are a silly person, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not going to hold you responsible. He's not going to tell you, why didn't you pray? You understand this? So mad people or silly people, Allah does not hold them responsible. So, but if I choose the easy way, I want the quick pleasure now. I have the same exact influence from the shaitan. But because I believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I control myself. The other one does not. So it is not an inherent weakness in him from the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Is this clear?
It is. It's definitely clear. But, you know, again, what's confusing here is that this is where you need to explain, you know. Allah Himself said, wa yahdi bihi kaseeran wa yudillu bihi kaseeran.
Of course.
So,
I just explain it. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He say, I misguide, Allah does not misguide. If you choose to be misguided, and no matter what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put on your way to bring you back to Him, and you insist, the misguidance from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not a misguidance, is Allah will leave you alone.
Yeah, just to give an example, Sheikh Fareed, like that, I'm sorry to interrupt you, is Abu Jahl. Okay?
Abu Jahl.
Yeah. I mean, the surah came in, if he was smart, have some decent kind of amount of thinking, he would have reversed right away, because the surah came in to discredit the ground right away. Yeah. I mean, say, no, I'm Muslim. But he was so misguided that, and before even anything else, I mean,
Even regardless of religion, if you talk about in our society, if I love and care about Noor, okay, I always sit down with him and spend the time and try to hold his hand and try to get him on the right path. I do this over and over and over and over. But there is no response. When I leave you alone and I do not do this anymore, am I misguiding you?
Yeah.
And walillahi al-mathal al-a'la, the same thing. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, leave you alone because you insist on what you do, Allah does not misguide, hasha lillahi, He misguide. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is using language that you and I should understand. Okay? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He say, فَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ هَدَى اللَّهِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guided. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide. Allah subhanahu, I'm going to give you one ayah. This will explain it very clear. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-An'am. No, in Surah Yunus. Huh? Surah number 10, ayah number 9. And I want you to listen to this. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ يَهْدِيهِمْ رَبُّهُمْ بِإِيمَانِهِمْ. Those who believe and do good deeds, Allah will guide them because of their iman. You understand this? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not play games with us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not come and He say, you know, I'm going to guide Ra'fat, I'm going to misguide Muhammad Hassan. Hasha lillah, Allah does not do this. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us all to go to Him. Okay? But He's giving us a free will. And if you choose and you insist to stay on that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not give up on us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put lots of things in front of us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if you are choose to be misguided, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will push in your way a friend who loves you and always try to give you advice. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make you suffer something so you can go back to Him. He's not going to leave you alone. But at the end of the day, if you insist and you choose to stay that course, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not going to misguide you, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will leave you alone. But if He left you alone, you are done. You understand? So, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ يَهْدِيهِمْ رَبُّهُمْ بِإِيمَانِهِمْ. Okay? In another ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say, وَالَّذِينَ اهْتَدَوْا. People who seek guidance, زَادَهُمْ هُدَى. So if you seek guidance, if you wake up before Fajr and you plead with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give you guidance, you think he's gonna turn his back on you? No. But if you oversleep and you do not pray Fajr and you get up and make dua, he's not gonna listen to you. You understand? So when you put the effort, the Prophet ﷺ give us a beautiful hadith. He say, if you go to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala walking, he will come to you running. If you go to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala this much, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will come to you this much. You understand? So it is us that we choose our destiny, not Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay?
Also, you know, the example
I know this guy confused everybody, but yeah, go ahead.
Two brothers. And, you know, sometimes to me it seems like, you know, by myself or by oneself, I think it's very hard to fight shaitan. You know, like to doing any job, you need tools and you need equipment.
Right.
And I think the tool you need to fight shaitan is the connection with Allah.
Absolutely.
Allah's help, otherwise I'm not that strong by myself. And I think that's where the difference becomes, that if I try to make that connection, and then I ask a wise person, so he's gonna give me a good advice.
Yes.
So when she develops that connection, I'm getting a good advice, I'm acting upon it, so I'm setting myself for success.
You know what Brother Osman said? This is exactly how I explain to my kids when they really young, for them to understand. I say, and this is, I said, if you are in your alley, if you're in your area, every kid beats you, okay? Everybody bullies you, huh? Because you are weak. But one day, he came to your street holding the hand of your father. Would anybody come near you? Nobody. You are the same guy, but the difference is you are holding tight to somebody who can protect you. You understand? So everybody disappear from the street. وَلِلَّهِ الْمَثَلُ الْأَعْلَى. If you connect with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the shaitan have very little influence over you. But if you disconnect yourself from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you are vulnerable. And we choose that, okay? Because we, unfortunately, we go for the quick fix. I want pleasure now. I want results now. I want to have fun now. As a young guy, I wanna go with girls because I do not want to wait 5 years and get my, you understand this? So it is the defense that you should have, and the only thing that protects you is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay? فانظر كيف كان عاقبة المكذبين. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also in Surah Al-Layl, he say, فأما من أعطى واتقى وصدق بالحسنى. Anybody who have taqwa and he give and he believe in the day after, فسنيسره لليسر. And the ulama say تيسير أو توفيق. This is what they call it, divine assistance. This is something for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make worshipping him something that pleases you. It does not become a burden. You enjoy it. There is sweetness in worshiping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the more you go to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the more you plead. You know, when we hear the adhan and the muadhin say, حي على الصلاة حي على الفلاح. What do we say? لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله. Do we understand what that means? لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله. I cannot do anything like Uthman say. We cannot do anything without Allah سبحانه وتعالى. الإمام مالك he say استحالة. It does not make any sense. It is impossible that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will punish anybody who do istighfar. And they ask him why. He say, because when you do istighfar, it is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is triggering this in you. When you good, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala trigger something in you to do more good. You understand this? But if you're not, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will leave you alone. So if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is triggering something for you to make istighfar, he would never punish you, because he wants goodness for you. So how come he wants goodness for you and to give you tawfiq to do istighfar and to do good deeds, and Allah will punish you? So the notion that Allah misguide has to be understood.
Right.
Allah does not misguide. If you choose misguidance and you stay on it, no matter what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does for you to go back to him, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, at one point in time, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will leave you alone. And this is the misguidance. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hashah in that he misguide. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to understand the ayah also, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala always talk about things. Wallahu la yahdi al-qawm al-zalimeen. If you commit injustice, if you are a tyrant, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not going to give you hood. You understand? Wallahu la yahdi al-qawm al-fasiqeen. If you always rebel away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, does not listen to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not going to give you hood. Allah give you hood if you ask for it. You understand this? Inna Allah la yahdi man huwa kadhibun kaffar. Allah would not guide anybody who is a denier and also a liar. Inna Allah la yahdi man huwa musrifun kadhab. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but at the same time, the contrast. Inna alladhina la yu'minuna bi ayati Allah la yahdihum Allah. But the other contrast. إن الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات يهديهم ربهم بإيمانهم. So we ask for it. You know, if you have a kid and you always ask him, give him advice, and he does not listen, and he get in big trouble, what would you tell him? You ask for it.
Yeah.
You know, I tried the best I can, but what can I do? So we want. When we hear the word Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala misguide, you have to understand it. Allah does not misguide. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he leave you alone, that is the biggest misguidance. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَلِلَّهِ الْمَثَلُ الْأَعْلَى, I'm using the wrong word. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give up on you. Okay? إِن تَحْرِصْ عَلَى هُدَاهُمْ, Ayah 37, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala now counseling Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was keen. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to hurt himself psychologically inside when he see people run away from Islam. He wants people to come to the field of Islam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala counseling him. He say, take it easy. This is not your job. In tahris ala hudahum. If you are eager, you have tremendous desire that they will be guided. فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَهْدِي مَنْ يُضِلْ. No. If they continue on dalal, if they continue going this route and they never listen, never even try. Sayyidina Umar, think about Sayyidina Umar. Sayyidina Umar, inside, he was very, very clean. But he was, you know, Sayyidina Umar, one day he say, we had intellect, but we did not have guidance. You understand? As people in Jahiliyyah, we have brains, we have intellect. But the intellect without guidance does not really mean anything. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala telling the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that when people insist on going the wrong way, Allah will never guide them, no matter what you do. Because the Prophet sallam, he was very eager that everybody to come. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Kahf, فَلَعَلَّكَ بَاخِعُ النَّفْسَكَ عَلَىٰ آثَرِهِمْ. Ya Muhammad, you're going to kill yourself. He was so eager to see people to come to Islam and leave that. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَمَا لَهُمْ مِنْ نَاصِرِينَ. In fact, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to teach Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his uncle, which was the biggest supporter of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam could not guide him. He intellectually, he believed in Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But because of the time of ignorance, jahiliyyah, he does not want to say that I left the deen of my father and the forefather and stuff like this. So what was to him, this is something big. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he say, you can be eager to get people to guidance, but guidance is not within your power. It's me. The only one who give guidance is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam things that if you follow it, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told him, ila siratin mustaqim. If people listen to you and ponder and reflect on what you have, that will lead them to guidance. Not you, what you have. But the one who actually give guidance is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why we need to understand one thing, wallahi. When I get up and do something really good, if I am really a mu'min, if I am truly a mu'min, and working within the framework of tawheed, the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I become more humble, and I put my head on the floor and thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because in reality, when we do something good, it is Allah is triggering us to do something good. But He trigger you to do something good, not because your eye color is blue. Because He sees in you real desire to be guided. So when Allah, that's why the Prophet say, "Inna al-qalba mawdu'u nazar al-Rabb." Our heart, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not look at our shape from outside. He look at your heart. If He really see you, that you are really truly want Him, you seeking Him, you want, and you go to Allah, "Ya Allah, I am trying. I need Your help." And He'll never turn His back to you. You understand this? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala counsel the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in ala hudahum. No matter how eager you are, you can never give them guidance. I am the only one. فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَهْدِي مَنْ يُضِلْ وَمَا لَهُمْ مِنْ نَاصِرِينَ. It is the Prophet's job is only to relay the message. إِنْ عَلَيْكَ إِلَّا الْبَلَاغِ. إِنَّكَ لَا تَهْدِي مَنْ أَحْبَبْتَ وَلَكِنَّ اللَّهَ يَهْدِي مَنْ يَشَاءَ. You do not guide whoever you love, only Allah guide whoever He wish or whoever He will. But again, the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not haphazard. We need to understand this. Because مَا يَشَاءَ, whatever He will, that's not injustice. His will conform with our will. If I really seriously wish to be guided, hasha lillah, that He will leave me alone. He will guide me. وَأَقْسَمُوا بِاللَّهِ جَهْدَ أَيْمَانِهِمْ لَا يَبْعَثُ اللَّهُ مَنْ يَمُوتُ. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala go back to talk about people who deny the resurrection day, the day of judgment. وَأَقْسَمُوا بِاللَّهِ جَهْدَ أَيْمَانِهِمْ لَا يَبْعَثُ اللَّهُ مَنْ يَمُوتُ بَلَا وَعْدًا عَلَيْهِ حَقًّا وَلَكِنَّ أَكْثَرَ النَّاسِ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ. So these people is sworn by Allah with the utmost of their vows, all effort, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not raise to life anyone who dies. The answer from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, بَلَا, yes indeed, He will. It is a true promise. وَعْدًا عَلَيْهِ حَقًّا. It is a true promise. It is binding. It is incumbent upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to fulfill that. وَلَكِنَّ أَكْثَرَ النَّاسِ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ. Though most people do not know it. The funny thing about this ayah is even the atheist, the polytheist at the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when they want to really make a strong vow, solemn pledge, they only swear by Allah. It's a fact. Huh? But if it is something trivial, they can swear by Allah, Al-Uzza, whatever it is. It is like today, if you live and know people who are Christian, if there is a real disaster, they never say Jesus. Think about it. Never. Jesus, if they spill the coffee.
Yeah,
you understand? Something hot came on them, they of Jesus. But if there is a disaster, no Jesus. Oh my God. You understand? So this is embedded in us. This is in there. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he say, وَأَقْسَمُوا بِاللَّهِ جَهْدَ أَيْمَانِهِمْ. So when they really want to make a binding vow or pledge, they mention Allah. But in the meantime, they deny him the ability to resurrect. You understand this?
Yeah, it's amazing because if anybody that has the right brain, we die every night and wake up in the morning.
Absolutely.
How come you can't really even understand that? It's the same technique, but Allah has a different, whatever he does. But
Allah,
at night, we don't really feel anything, and then we wake up in the morning.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it very clear in the Quran that there is no true disbelievers. There is no true disbelievers. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say, فَإِنَّهُمْ لَا يُكَذِّبُونَكَ وَلَكِنَّ الظَّالِمِينَ بِآيَاتِ اللَّهِ يَجْحَدُونَ. This is the easy way. If I am a thief, if I am womanizing, if I drink, if I smoke, I would love to see the whole society doing the same thing. Because when I see good people, that hurt me inside. You understand? But to comfort me, I want to see everybody in the same thing, doing the same thing like me.
Is yakhadun is like they are...
They want to deny it. Al-juhud, that you do not... If you have a kid that you do not take care of him, that's juhud. You do not give him what belongs to him. You do not give him what he deserves. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he say, وَلَكَنُوا بِأَتْلَا يَتْحَدُونَ. They know Allah inside, but they still do not want to give Allah the ranking and the station that he wants. Because They wanna convince themselves that kufr is a good way. There is nothing wrong with that. You understand? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he say, وَأَقْسَمُوا بِاللَّهِ جَهْدَ أَيْمَانِهِمْ لَا يَبْعَثُ اللَّهُ مَنْ يَمُوتُ. They swear by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the strongest, the most sincere, the most sacred, the solemn oath, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, They put Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala up there, and they say, he's not going to do that. But here is the thing. When you deny the day of judgment, you deny all the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, one of the scholars, he said, I want you to think about one thing. Because people who say that there is no day of judgment, two things. The first one is they really belittling themselves. You understand this? If you and I, that we have brains and we have intellect, we have the ability to sense, we have the ability to decode, we have the ability to do all these things, to invent. If you say that I will be ending like a rat, and I would be ending like an earthworm, we all gonna be dust and everybody's gonna be happy. If you say this, you actually lowering yourself to the lowest creature. You understand? So, believing the day of judgment, you actually putting yourself up here. And the second one of the ulama, he say, give a nice example. He say, in this dunya, and there is, this is this one case scenario. He say, in this dunya, somebody bought 100 acres, and he built a state-of-the-art university, and he hired the best professors and the best equipment, everything. But there is no test at the end of the year. You just go spend 4 years. Even if you stay in the bar, after 4 years you get your, you can be a doctor, you can be a lawyer without studying. Does this make any sense? He say, if this does not make any sense in a university, how could it make sense in the universe? This is the university and the universe, okay? And also, you denying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala his name Al-Adl. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say, أَفَنَجْعَلُ الْمُسْلِمِينَ كَالْمُجْرِمِينَ مَا لَكُمْ كَيْفَ تَحْكُمُونَ. Do you think the people who were tyrant, people who is killing thousands of people, people displacing, look at what's happening in Syria, look at what's happening in every place. Is this person gonna be dust? And Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam also gonna be dust? And that's the end of it? That you denying the name just Al-Adl. You denying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala everything, Al-Adl, Al-Shakur, Al-Rahim, Al-Hakim, everything. You stripping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from all his beautiful attributes. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he say, this is wa'dan alayhi haqqa. This is thing that certainly it will take place. Okay? لِيُبَيِّنَ لَهُمُ الَّذِي يَخْتَلِفُونَ فِيهِ. One of the things, one of the reason for the day of judgment, so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make things clear. The ulama say, if you think about the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Al-Adl, he say most of the names is manifested in this dunya, except Al-Adl. Al-Adl is manifested just certain percentage, but true Adl is gonna be manifested on the day of judgment. You see, even in this dunya, you see tyrants, you see killers, they die and nothing happened to them in this dunya. You understand this? Nothing happened to them. They die, natural cause and stuff like this. And the justice of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be fully implemented on the day of judgment. That's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. لِيُبَيِّنَ لَهُمْ الَّذِي يَخْتَلِفُونَ فِيهِ. To make it evident to them the reality of the afterlife. This is what they dispute, which they now dispute. وَلْيَعْلَمَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا, and that those who disbelieve will plainly know that they indeed were ever liars.
But Shaykh, in this ayah, it's really, it's the Quraysh of Makkah that they are being addressed, right?
Not only, the originally them, but anybody who act like them, okay? We have millions of people who are atheists. We have millions of people, even the Jews today, they do not believe in Day of Judgment.
Oh, they don't?
Of course, and then it's gone. Okay, they're gonna be in their dreams, in their graves, having nice dreams and stuff like this. Somebody gonna have some dreams, nice dreams, somebody gonna have nightmares. There is nothing there. Lots of people do not, you know something? If I tell you that there is a raging fire behind this closed door, and if you open it, the fire will reach you and you're not gonna escape it. When you open the door, what does this mean?
You didn't believe that.
You do not believe, or you are super nuts. Okay? So there are people, I wanna comfort myself. Not only fakely I believe that there is no day of judgment. I wanna lie until everybody, until first I'm convinced, and all somebody else around me, they think the same way. Okay? So there are lots of people, either they do not believe, they make believe they do not believe, or they actually, some people put their head in the sand thinking that there is no danger. You understand? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He warned us, that is out of His rahmah. Huh? When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, at the end of the ayah, when He say, إِنَّ اللَّهَ شَدِيدُ الْعِقَابِ. Some people say, يَا أَخِي, Quran is very, very, very tough. Huh? Very, very harsh. Huh? No, no, no. The way I see it, it's very soft. When you sit down, when we have a loving kid, you love him so much, and you keep warning him, if this means that you are harsh, or this is coming out of compassion and love. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He say, لِيُبَيِّنَ لَهُمُ الَّذِي يَخْتَلِفُونَ وَلْيَعْلَمَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا أَنَّهُ. And all these ayat was revealed not only as a threat, and not only to say that you're gonna be in the hellfire. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to trigger something in these people. One thing you need to understand, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can force us to iman. Nice. Like all other creatures. They have no will. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with us, when He give us the intellect and give us all these proofs, Allah love for us to go to Him as a person choice. Not being arm twisted. That's not what He want. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala love for us to believe in Him. Love for us to go to Him. Love for us, every one of us, even the kuffar, they have their own Jannah. Everyone has his own Jannah.
It's already pre-made.
Absolutely. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows at the end of the day where we're going to end up. But some of us and the kuffar, we fight so hard not to go there. The reality is, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to trigger something in us. I warn you because I want you to come back to me. Not warning you because you are doomed. When you warn your kid over and over and over, that's out of love, not out of hatred. Huh? Or you wish for him to be doomed. Nobody wishes his son to be doomed. Okay? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in ayah 40, He say, when you think I am not gonna do that, then there is no day of resurrection. If this is in your head, one of the biggest thing about people, and this is one of the big thing about Christianity. People actually, when it comes to Allah, people out of ignorance think of Allah as a human being. Think of the capability of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If what does this mean? So it is so out of place that this is gonna happen. Okay? But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He say, think of me as me. Not I am the creator, I'm not a creation. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah 40, He say, إِنَّمَا قَوْلُنَا. Don't think of me that I am not limited to time or things, or that there is nothing there. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala create from nothing, and He create without any pre-model. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whatever He was, He say, إِنَّمَا قَوْلُنَا لِشَيْءٍ إِذَا أَرَدْنَاهُ أَن نَقُولَ لَهُ كُنْ فَيَكُونَ. It is, and our word unto a thing, anything, when we desire it, it is only to say be and it is. Sheikh Sharaw, He say, the word be is too long. With Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it's too long. Once Allah will, He doesn't have to say it be. Once He wills it, it happens. And this is one of the things that we need to understand. One of the things that we need to do, every one of us, is seriously study the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is vital for every Muslim. It is vital because when you get at our level as a human being, there is no way we can actually understand who Allah is. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, at our level as human being, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give us enough knowledge to know Him at our level, because there is no way we can understand Him. So when you know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, everything would be easy in your life. When you know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is al-wadud, al-wadud, is the one, is not only loving, it is loving beyond imagination. Al-wud, when a woman is just to give birth, she went through hell giving birth, and they hand her the baby, and she took him to her breast. She's so happy, and she is just holding. This is wood. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say, I am wadud. He loves us more than your mother loves you. Imam Ahmad, he say, wallahi, if I have a choice on the day of judgment, they tell me, who do you want to be the judge? Allah or your mother? I will absolutely pick Allah. Forget about my mother, because she's gonna have her own problem. Okay, everybody's gonna has own problem. So this is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He say, "Innama qawluna." When we read this ayah, we need to understand who Allah is. If you really understand Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Hashr, He say, "Wala takunu kalladhina nasu Allah fa'ansahum anfusahum." Don't be like those people who forget Allah. Allah made them forget themselves. This is ayah. Three ayat after this. Wallahi, this Quran is so amazing, so beautiful. He warned us to forget Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَلَا تَكُونُوا كَالَّذِينَ نَسُوا اللَّهَ فَانْسَوْا أَنفُسَهُمْ. Three ayat. Allah introduced Himself. And He mentioned 16 of His names. هو الله الذي لا إله إلا هو عالم الغيب والشهادة هو الرحمن الرحيم هو الله الذي لا إله إلا هو الملك القدوس السلام المؤمن المهيمن العزيز الجبار المتكبر سبحان الله عما يشركون هو الله الخالق البارئ المصور له الأسماء الحسنى يسبح له ما في السماوات وهو العزيز الحكيم 16 attribute. He just does not say, don't forget me, but this is who I am.
This is very assuring. You really don't have to worry about it.
Absolutely.
I mean, if you really digest this ayah alone,
absolutely, wallah,
it can be enough for you for a little more entire life.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when you get to know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whatever happened to you in your life, it is totally accepted. Whether you like it or not, you accepted. Sometimes we accept things because we have no choice. I accepted, but I hate it. You understand this? But with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you accepted and you very comfortable, because nothing goes to waste with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Nothing. If you get poked with a throne, nothing. What would an average American say? If he is very polite, he will say the S word, isn't it? But when you get this and they say Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen, Allah will give you hasana and erase sayyi'a. So yes, it is painful, but alhamdulillah, Allah knows that I need that hasana, and He's gonna take sayyi'ah. He knows that I am loaded. You understand this? So nothing happened to you in this dunya, that when you accept it, because when you know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you have absolutely no problem. You accept what He does, Because what he does, wallahu ya'lamu antum la ta'lamun. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he has the knowledge. He knows what's happened. Look at you and look at I. I personally, in my lifetime, there was things that I was willing to give half of my life for me to happen. And today when I look back, I thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala it not happened. Isn't it? I'm very sure each one of us has incidents like this. But at that time, you were so keen and you were so disappointed that this does happen. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, at that time, He said, trust me. But we don't hear Him. And now, after years, you thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that it did not happen. وَاللَّهُ يَعْلَمُ أَنْتُمْ لَتَعْلَمُونَ وَعَسَىٰ أَنْ تَكْرَهُ شَيْئًا وَهُوَ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ. والله في سورة الأنفال الله سبحانه وتعالى, the companions went because there was a caravan that the kuffar, the caravan was passing by Medina. So they say the kuffar in Mecca, they stole our money, they took everything, so we want to take that. Well, you know, it's fair. So they went out for the caravan. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala switched the whole thing. And the caravan was saved. And the Meccan came in to punish the Muslim. And this was the Battle of Badr, which this was the start of the Muslim Ummah. So the ulama say, one of the scholars in Egypt, he called Sayyid Qutb rahmatullah alayhi, he say, imagine if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would give the Muslims what they wanted at that time. Having the caravan, you are only a highway robber. There is, you know, what did he do? What did he accomplish? But when Allah made it the Battle of Badr, Allah called it Yawm al-Furqan. This was the beginning of the Muslim Ummah. When the Muslim beat the Kuffar on Badr, there was a Muslim Ummah that all Arabia were afraid of. You understand? See, this is what we want. We want some caravan, but Allah wants something else. But at that time also, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He say that some people hated that battle. كأنما يساقون الموت وهم ينظرون. Some people did not want the battle. They want to live. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala showed them after the battle. Should you go with your will or with my will? Okay? إنما قولنا إلى لشيء إذا أردناه أن يقول أن نقول له كن فيكون.
Can you explain why Allah says إنما قولنا, why not إنما قولي?
When Allah, two things. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He talk about worshipping Him, He used the singular. Okay. He say, I. Innani an Allah. Okay? When He talk about His action, He use what we call the royal form. Okay? Which is, even in our dunya, if you see, for instance, a king writing a new law or something, he say nahnu, we, does not say I. This is called the royal form. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the real king. He used the royal, not because He is the king, because any action of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, any action of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala needs more than one of His attributes. You understand this? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He create, He is the creator, He use His wisdom, He use His knowledge, He is the mubdi, He is al. You understand this? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not use the singular form, He use the plural, okay? But always, when He talk about worshipping, He say I. When He talk about His action, He say we, okay? So that's why the ulama say, Ashraf al-Ulum, the most honorable branch of science, of knowledge, is the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. التوحيد, understanding who Subhanallah subhanahu wa ta'ala is. When you understand his 99 names, things will be a lot more easier when you face this dunya. Okay? آية 41, والذين هاجروا في الله من بعد ما ظلموا لنبوئنهم في الدنيا حسنة ولأجر الآخرة أكبر لو كانوا يعلمون. الله سبحانه وتعالى talk about now initially, Allah سبحانه وتعالى is talking about people who actually migrated from Mecca to Medina. والذين هاجروا, as of those who immigrated or migrated in the cause of Allah سبحانه وتعالى. Why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala used the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Because some people migrated not for the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay? There was a guy who wanted to migrate because the woman that he wants to marry migrated. So he wanted to migrate. So why the ayah is talking about this? Just to emphasize to us that our job, our deeds, revolve around our niyyah.
Our what?
Niyyah, our intention. Our intention is a lot more powerful and a lot more needed than the action itself. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he say, وَمَنْ يَخْرُجْ مِنْ بَيْتِهِ مُهَاجِرًا إِلَى اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ. If you have the intention to leave your house and migrate, leave your town and go do migration for the sake of Allah and His Messenger. وَمَنْ يَخْرُجْ مِنْ بَيْتِهِ ثُمَّ يُدْرِكْهُ الْمَوْتِ, and he dies. I have the intention to go leave this because I wanna save my deen. I wanna go someplace else to practice my deen. I have 1 foot in my house and 1 foot outside of my house, and I drop dead. Your reward is done. فَقَدْ وَقَعَ أَجْرُهُ عَلَى اللَّهِ. The ajr is written. So I did not migrate, but the reward of migration is written. You understand this? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَالَّذِينَ هَاجَرُوا فِي اللَّهِ, people who migrated for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I want you to think about this. The companions who left their homes, they left their homes. Most of them, they were very comfortable. Uthman was very rich. Ali was very comfortable. Huzaifa ibn al-Yaman, all of them. When you leave your own town, when you leave all these memories, when you leave your family, your tribe, when you leave your kids, when you leave your money, and leave everything, and you go just with the piece of cloth on your back, and you go, what does this mean? Total trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Everything that you leave behind, you know that this is insignificant comparing to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will have for you. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَالَّذِينَ هَاجَرُوا فِي اللَّهِ مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا ظُلِمُوا. I was subject to injustice. لَنُبَوِّئَنَّهُمْ فِي الدُّنْيَا حَسَنَةً. They will be rewarded in this dunya. Because there is a big misconcept. The people think that when you become a good mu'min, you're going to be living a miserable life, but the reward is going to be on the day of judgment. That's not true.
I want to go back to the Ladina Hajar of that. The meaning of hijra for Allah.
Okay.
It can be definitely you want to rest regarding your religion, but also a lot of us also don't want that really the crummy system that we lived in as a growing
okay.
up,
yeah.
corruption, this, and either if you want to live there and this is a Muslim country, you have to be corrupted to be able to
yeah.
do whatever. So a lot of us moved, but not because of really the pure religion like the first ones.
I understand. I was going to talk about this, but that's fair. There is three meanings to hijra. Okay, the first one is the original one, which actually people who migrated from Mecca to Medina. leaving everything behind, totally trust Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that type of hijrah is done. You cannot do it anymore. Once people la hijrah ba'd al-fath, after the conquer of Mecca, and Mecca became a Muslim country, there is no hijrah. That hijrah is done. Okay, there is hijrah again, which is the same thing, which is the historical hijrah is when people moved from Mecca to Medina. But there is another hijrah, okay, which is what you're talking about. You know, at the time of Abd al-Nasr, for instance, in Egypt, when he tortured the Muslim, lots of people, they could not have any choice but to leave Egypt. And they left Egypt, they left their money, they left everything. That's also hijrah. Because I want to escape. If you think about the people of the cave, Ahl al-Kahf, these people were from the elite, but they were pressured to leave their deen and to go back to Kufr. And they give us everything, and they went to the cave to think and to see what they're going to do. So they left everything. This is hijrah. And this also can be also seen in our case. If you are in a country where you really cannot practice your deen, you have no freedom, that hijrah has to be done. قالوا كنا صحيحين قالوا ألم تكن أرض الله واسعة فتهاجروا فيها. If I cannot practice, if I am in the United States now, and the new law, the new environment, I cannot go to the masjid, I cannot practice my deen, it is incumbent on me to leave. There is no ifs and buts about it. So if you are subjected to injustice someplace, and you wanna keep your deen, you wanna practice your deen, okay? And not only the deen, that you have no job, you have no future, whatever it is, and you wanna go establish something, that is hijrah, okay? But there is a beautiful hijrah that the Prophet ﷺ give us that tightening. The Prophet ﷺ, he say, لا هجرة بعد الفتح. After the conquer of Mecca, there is no hijrah. ولكن for you and I to be in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as المهاجرين, that we migrate away from what displeases Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. ولكن جهاد ونية, you struggle against yourself, you stay away from the haram, you strive for the halal, and you have a good intention. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, out of his mercy, none of us, very, very few of us, can be rated as the first generation of the Prophet. These are the tops. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he say that some of you will be rewarded like them. Okay, so each one of us, we did not live at the time of hijrah, okay? But today, if you and I strive, and we put our soul under control, and we strive to stay away from we do hijrah, I am living in haram, or surrounded with haram, and I leave this behind. This is hijrah. ولكن جهاد ونية. Okay? Clear? Okay. Now, الله سبحانه وتعالى يقول والذين هاجروا في الله من بعد ما ظلموا لنبوي أنهم في الدنيا حسنة. And this is very important. If you look at the Sahaba, which were there, الله سبحانه وتعالى describe them in Mecca that they were almost like small birds walking, afraid that somebody will come and snatch them. واذكروا إذ أنتم قليل مستضعفون في الأرض تخافون أن يتخطفكم الناس. They were the Muslim in Mecca. They were very afraid, like a chicken, you know, walking, you know, very very close to the wall. afraid that a big bird will come and snatch them. فَآوَاكُمْ وَأَيَّدَكُمْ بِنَصْرِهِ وَرَزَقَكُمْ مِنَ الطَّيِّبَاتِ. The Sahaba, in their life, most of them became ruler. So the reward in this dunya is not only for the hereafter, because some people think, if I am a good person, if I worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I have to live a miserable life in order to get the reward. No, that's not true. And furthermore, that even if you're not living a lavish materialistic life, there is a lavish spiritual life. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give you contentment. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give you the taste of the nearness to Him, the sweetness of the nearness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ahlul Suffa, which is the poorest of the poorest, they have no wives, they have no kids, they have no money, they have no places, sitting down, socializing. And one of them to look at the other one, he say, if the kings of this dunya knows the beauty that we living in, they will come fight us with the sword. What type of beauty? Huh? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, only if he has some milk or something like this, will give them. But there is a satisfaction inside. There is absolutely no worry. Sheikh Nablusi, we were talking about the Emirate. He have a beautiful story. He said some of the hotels in the Arab Emirate for the night, $10,000 for the night. He say, I got a call when he was in Syria. He said, I got a call from a friend of mine that I know him, that he was spending the night in one of these hotels. He awakened Sheikh about 3 o'clock in the morning. And he say, "Ya Sheikh, I want you to know what I'm going through. I am here in that suite, $10,000 a night. Anything that I want, there is food, there is everything. If I pay $10,000 for a night, I'm not gonna go to sleep. I wanna just enjoy and touch everything there." And he say, "I am sitting there. I cannot go to sleep. And I look out at the balcony and the gardener is sleeping sound under a tree. I, with all the money that I have, with the pills, the sleeping pills, I cannot sleep. I worry. I have plenty of money and I wanna know how to invest that. I have worry, tremendous worry. So the money, the wealth, the power, instead of something that you enjoy, it become a curse. The other guy does not have a thing, and he's snoring under the tree. Who is the happiest? Huh? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, لَنُبَوِّئَنَّهُمْ فِي الدُّنْيَا حَسَنَةً. There is goodness for them in this dunya. It's not only that you're gonna live a miserable life and then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward you. وَلَا أَجْرُ الْآخِرَةِ أَكْبَرُ. No matter what I give them in this dunya, that is nothing. Huh? When compared to what the reward and the hereafter would be.
تفضل. Regarding intention, I know the intention may it should be 100% for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Yeah.
Sometimes I feel like it's maybe not 100%. So
you're gonna go to hell. No. Astaghfirullah al-Azim. Astaghfirullah. Yeah, go ahead. Yeah.
So is that, no, that intention, we want it to be 100%, yes. And sometimes, let's say, it's for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we're trying to lose weight too and stuff like that. Should we kind of just...
Shuf, akhi, one thing you have to understand. Okay. That perfection only belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You have to understand that. Perfection belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When it comes to niyyah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to be 100%, that niyyah, 100% pure. One of the things that it will fix your niyya is actually to have the niyya that Allah will help you. You go to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and I go to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I go, I am broken. I go to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and I say, I'm going to tell you something, wallahi. Wallahi, I never do anything that I am 100% positive about my niyya. One of the tabi'een, I do not remember his name, he said, I met 25 of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and they were afraid that they are hypocrites. You understand? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from us sincerity. I go to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allahumma aslih niyyati. Iddu'a akhi, iddu'a. Without du'a, without pleading with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you go astray. So I am not really sure if my niyyah is totally for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I give the khutbah, and when I come down, and somebody come to me and say, brother, alhamdulillah, wallahi, this was a beautiful thing. Am I looking for that? Or it just happened? You understand this? There is a huge big difference between this and this. If I'm looking for that praise, whatever I did has absolutely no meaning. But if it happens, that's from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But because I am not really 100% sure, 100% sure, I always, before I do something, Allahumma ja'al niyyati khalisatan ilayk. Oh Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, help me to purify my niyya. Because without the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we cannot do a thing. Even with the niyya. With the niyya, the dua, always. You know, Ramadan comes. You plead with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, oh Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is my chance. I do not know if I'm going to have another Ramadan or not. Ya Allah, help me with my niyyah. And also, you make the dua, but you do not entertain any passing thought. You understand this? If there is a passing thought, that they call it hajis in Arabic, they call it hajis, something comes to you. If this does not conform with a good niyyah, don't entertain it. Okay? You dismiss it right away. And you ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help you with your niyyah. None of us, Sayyidina Abu Bakr, he say, if I have 1 foot outside al-Jannah and 1 foot inside the Jannah, I'm not comfortable yet. I won't have both of them there. You understand this? This is the reality. And the Prophet ﷺ, the Prophet ﷺ went to visit a companion. And the companion was sick. The Prophet ﷺ, he say, كيف حالك? How do you feel? You know what his answer was? He did not say, Alhamdulillah, I am good or I'm improving. He say, Ya Rasul Allah, أرجو ربي وأخاف ذنبي. Ya Rasul Allah, I have high hopes in Allah, but I am very fearful of my bad deeds. I do not know if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive my bad deeds or not. Although I have high hopes. Prophet ﷺ, he say, مَجْتَمَعَ فِي قَلْبِ رَجُلٍ. These two things. You have high hope in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and you're not arrogant. You have high hopes, but you fear your deeds. He say, if these combined in the heart of a person, Allah will give you what you want and protect you from what you fear. So you and I, you know something, you're sitting home and all of a sudden you feel the urge. It's not the time to pray, but you feel the urge to get up and make wudu and pray 2 rak'ah. Do you think this is coming from you? No. It's coming from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is looking at you and he see goodness in you. So he inspire you to do that. The more Allah look inside us and see purity and beauty, Allah inspire us to do things. when I make istighfar, I can be sitting in my car for 1 hour listening to garbage news about, you know, the Trump and all these things. Huh? And I can turn it off and make istighfar and make dhikr. When I do this, this is from Allah. Everything that we do, وَمَا كُنَّا لِنَهْتَدِيَ لَوْلَا أَنْ هَدَانَ اللَّهِ. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he look at your heart and see goodness and see purity and beauty, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala inspire you to do good things. So we always go to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Before you do anything, you ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make this, اللهم اجعلها خالصة لوجهك. Ya Allah, make it, help me to purify my niyyah and make it solely for you, not for anybody else. Okay? But again, you're not alone. We all suffering from that. And we all have no refuge but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You go to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and go to Him, show your brokenness and your helplessness, and you ask Him to help you. Okay, Sheikh? Sheikh, we're going to stop here. And inshallah, we're going to open it for, we have about 15 minutes and 20 minutes until Maghrib, if you want to stay until Maghrib, and if you have a question, if you have a comment, if you have anything.